Hi, welcome to Advanced Ballistic Strikes. My name is Neil Franklin, one half of Franklin Spearco, the media company that's bringing you this production. And if you've seen Ballistic Strikes 1 and 2, I'm the guy that got hit. Okay, so this time, I'm going to step aside from the camera and we're going to bring some new guys on who you've not seen before, who Val hasn't even met before, when we go through the second series of Ballistic Striking. What we're going to cover in this DVD is the advanced techniques, striking, not only with the closed fist, with the open hand, different parts of the body, and pressure points, or what like Val, or sorry, what Val likes to call them, anatomy points. We're at a fantastic venue here today, and it's called Fight Time Fitness here in Sherman, Texas. And it's owned by Michael West. If I could bring Mr. West on. We've got an excellent facility with lots of equipment. So what I'd like to do first of all is look at some traditional striking methods. And I'm gonna bring on Tony Melton, who's a professional cage fighter from this gym, trained by Mike here, who has got a 7-0 record in his favor, I must say. So Tony, if you'd like to come on and I just wanna show Tony using traditional boxing, mixed martial arts, call it what you like, striking methods on the bags, which are right behind us here. Here, let's bring Tony on. Now, Tony's just gonna demonstrate what all of you martial arts guys and fighters know, probably backwards, basic punches. And he's gonna start. Open up a bit hard, really hard, give it some. Okay, good. So if we just come back for a second. Okay, so you've seen Tony here strike the bag, and what we're gonna talk about is just the basics of striking, how you get your body weight behind each punch. You're using the levers of the ankle, the knee, the hip, the waist, the shoulder, bang into the fist, using then the rotational force to throw your hooks, uppercuts, jabs and crosses, all traditional stuff. Now, why ballistic striking? Well, because number one, combat is extremely deadly and dangerous. What we're showing you here today is not necessary, it's not the be and end all of martial arts. It's a concept that you can adapt to any single martial art or striking method that you choose. And it's based on survival, combat survival. Now, in the ring, you have the luxury. We've got the cage up here, we've got the ring behind us. You have the luxury of a one-on-one opponent. You have rules, you have gloves. You know what you're doing. You stand there, you take it. This is why you take a defensive stance, because you know what's coming to you. In the reality of combat, you don't have that luxury. You have maybe a millisecond, if you're lucky, to now put all of your training, which we've just seen on the bag, into action. Bang, bang, bang. Does it work? Of course it works, because we see it every single day. Okay, if you're prepared, if you're a fighter, you have an advantage over a non-fighter, because you're conditioned to take punishment and to give punishment. But ballistic striking is about simply striking from any position. Now, I will tell you, and we know this from the first series, when you see the strikes, your first thought in your mind is, well, I don't believe this. It's too simple. It looks too relaxed. And the guy is obviously going down because he wants to go down. So let me just bring on a new member of the crew here, please. I'd like to introduce Tyler. Tyler is 275 pounds, roughly, I think, offensive lineman. And he's done some martial arts. And as you can see, he is no small guy, okay? Now, he's never met Val before. And this is the best way to start and demonstrate a ballistic strike. I've seen it, I've obviously been there, I've felt it, I've done it, and it hurts. So I just want Val to come on now and just strike Tyler. So what I want you to do, I'm gonna prepare you. If you just tense the back and your abdomen here, this is where he's gonna hit you. Now I'm gonna just warm you up with a little few strikes myself, so you get used to feeling. And then we're gonna bring Val on, and Val's just gonna hit him, okay? And I want you to just watch, number one, the effortlessness in the punch, and number two, the effect. Okay, so Val, if you come on, and we'll bring Val over this side, and he'll strike with his left hand, and I'm gonna step out the shot, and we're just gonna give him one strike.
Steady a few. Very good. Okay, I'll change to that. Okay. Can you see it?
Okay, so the camera doesn't lie, Tyler. Please be, how does it feel?
It just rattles everything. Rattles everything in your rib cage. It's not concentrated. It's okay. Don't worry about it. It's fine. It's not concentrated in one spot. It rattles kind of everything inside. I felt it where you hit me, and then up and below.
Now, what you saw there was a very simple, effortless strike. The sort of strike that you can pull from nowhere and put anywhere. But if we were to strike with maximum power, and we all know that, let's use the physics equation of force equals mass times acceleration. The faster we can accelerate our mass, the more force we can generate. But what's really happening here is that although it looks a very effortless and lazy punch, at the point of impact, there is an acceleration. And that acceleration is hitting beyond the muscle mass here. It's going straight into the body. And as we get more and more into this, we'll teach you where to put the strike, how to affect different organs, and basically what you can do to maximize the impact and the effect of any strike that you choose. So what you've got here, just in summary, is a very simple, and you see, effortless punch. If you was to speed that up and put more body weight behind it, the effect would be that much more dramatic. Okay, so now you've seen the strike. Let's just recap for those of you who haven't seen Ballistic Strikes 1 and 2. The basic structure of, the basic body structure, what we call the form, the breathing aspect, arm positioning, and how you actually make the strike into the individual. So Val is now going to demonstrate that. He's going to talk you through it with Tyler here as the example.
Well, first thing, remember, in traditional way to approach a striking, we've always been told you have to maintain the proper balance. And I totally agree with that. I never been disagree. But there is a situation when you cannot be in the total balance. We're talking about a situation in the real life. You know, you're next to a vehicle, you're in a parking lot, you're somewhere else, even you're in the octagon. You know, if you've been pushed towards the cage and someone keeps pushing you, you know, shutting down your lungs, you cannot breathe, you're halfway through to pass out, and your arms cannot gain you know, the distance to strike in, then, you know, how can you maintain this balance to put up a proper strike? So it's always conditional, do you understand what I mean? The point is, we try to approach it from a different perspective to understand how to generate that much power even though you don't have a balance and even though you don't have a breathing, you're almost out of breath, okay? A few different exercises, as long as we try to repeat what we did before. If you're standing in the front of your partner, totally square, or 1 foot forward, or another foot forward, depends which arm is your main punching arm, you know, you're left-handed or you're right-handed, we're gonna go that way. So basic thing is, if you apply your fist on your opponent and you gently push him away, if he moves away and you don't move, it means you have a good balance. It's as simple as you like, okay? If, for example, when you're pushing him, it requires your body to take the body weight forward to get him out, it means you're not in the balance. It means you're using your body weight within the strike. I think it's understandable. So, if you push him with your arm and you maintain the balance, it's a good balance. If you put your body weight behind it, then it's a tricky, because when he's do that as well, I'm resisting it. I can pull him in and he goes in. So it's a danger to be pulled in into some sort of action. If you start doing that and I step in and he moves behind me so he can walk in into the strike, it's a tricky situation again, right? So this is the main point I want to mention about balance. Next thing is the breathing. Breathing goes both ways. The first way, the one who's striking it. Anything you produce, from wrestling moves, throwing moves, striking moves, kicking moves, it always leaves my body within the breath out. You always exhale. I won't strike it. Yeah? Okay? But funny enough, it goes an opposite way exactly the same. When you get a strike as well, you have to exhale. If you get kicked, you have to exhale. Simplicity, simple thing to explain that is, whatever you're breathing in or breathing out, body have certain amount of oxygen within inside, within the lungs before that place, before the solar plexus in your lungs. When you inhale, your blood pressure goes up. When you exhale, it slightly goes down, but still there's a certain amount of pressure exists in your lungs. Your lungs sitting on the top of your heart, almost. So when the stress goes in into your body and you don't breathe in, breathe out, just hold it. So the pressure goes right across your chest, it's hitting your heart, it's suppressing your lungs, and they're pushing your solar plexus down, so it starts affecting your internal organs. That depends where the strike goes in. You can strike it in the stomach, and that will affect his heart. You strike it on the side, and it will affect his left lung if it travels through his tension. That's the main point I want to mention about breathing. You strike, you exhale. You've been striked, you exhale too. So that's why when you look at it at professional fighters, if you listen the way they breathe, it's always very, very simple. Yeah, they go. Inhale. Step away. Everybody heard that? If you notice it, you're fine. If you didn't notice it, you will notice it now. All right? This is basic repeat of the main bullet points from the first DVD.
Okay, so we're going to bring on now Tyler, we're going to bring Mike and Tony on, and Val is going to just teach them basic ballistic striking, the principles, the arm position, the footwork. Just a recap for those of you who have, recap for those of you who do have ballistic strikes 1 and 2, those of you who don't, a little taste of the previous DVDs, and we'll just bring these guys on now, and Val, if you can just teach them the basics.
Welcome back.
Thank you, sir.
Right, this is what I'm going to try to do. I'm going to show you a simple movement, and then I'll show you how to do it. I will explain what to do with it. And I want you to totally, completely relax. Yeah? Again, we're all powerful, you know. You teaching professional guys, he's you know, he's like a rock hard. This is like a machine. My God, you know, I'm the smallest one here. I want you to forget what you've done before, just for a split second. Try to do that, and then what we're going to do, we're going to take your own experience and sort of try to combine it with what you're trying now, and then we'll see what happens. Okay? That, you know, simple thing, you know, that's for the people who's going to try to do it. This is what I do. If you got to spread that a little bit, so you have a bit of room, so you move your arm, all right? Is it enough room? Okay, now this is what we do, guys. Remember, this is what I want you to do. I want you to repeat after me. You're going to put your arm in a 45 degree, yep, nice and steady. Right. You're going to raise your arm all the way back as far as you can without moving your body. All right? Now, it's there. Now, shoulder follows to the point you can't go any further. Let go of your shoulder. That's why I said, remember, relax. This is where you are. You raise your arm. That's it. Now, you try to let go of your shoulder. You gain another, probably, couple of centimeters. Now, you're going to get another shoulder behind it and the hip. But don't move the hip. Just the body, you know, the side muscles. Right? It's there. Very good. Now, try to just simply run it through. Almost like, that's it, like a steady movement. And you return your arm naturally back. So you don't sort of tuck it back in. Okay, but shoulder stays relaxed and the shoulder is not up, it stays down. That's it, there, like that. Hoop. That's very good. Okay, now, Tyler, try to add your body into the loop. Very good. Excellent. That's it. Gain the balance. Woof. Woof. Yeah, rotational movement. Again. There and woof. That's it. Very good. Shoulder down. There you go. Very excellent. That's the one. That's the one. Again. Now, from the beginning of the movement to the very end of the movement, I want long and sharp exhale. Breathe out. There you go. Right. Tony, make it longer. You're almost like you try to reach for something. Yeah? There you go. Try to reach for my arm. Reach it. There you go. Further. But stay in your own space. There you go. Relax your shoulder. Further. Stretch it. There you go again. Touch it. Try to touch it. There you go. Now, make it speedy. Fast, fast, fast. Fast. There you go. Go. Look at the body weight behind you. Yeah, you should keep the truck out of the road. Again. Very excellent. One more. Excellent. What I'm trying to put my stress onto, whatever the guys are going to practice now, this is the structural movement at the beginning. This is the fundamental movement. From big movement, we're going to make it short movement within the same power. So you spend much less than you have to, but the effort is not there anymore, but the impact is much greater than you ever done before, okay? Now, this is what we do. We're going to get apart together with Mr. Neil, and we're going to ask each one of the guys to strike the way they used to strike, okay? Let's make it a right hook.
Right hook?
Yeah. Very good. Go for it. Very good. Excellent. Very good. Now, go for Tyler. Right. Excellent. And tell to Mike. Excellent. Very good. Now, what we're trying to achieve now, we're not trying to show it they're not good, we're better. No, we're going to try to add something from us to their skill, and we'll see what happens. Just, you know, a little, you know, a little candy bar. Right? Right, okay. Now, so, do you remember what we did? I want you to raise it back, okay? And just reach, like I said, just reach and run it through it, like it's not there anymore.
You bring it back.
That's it, yeah, and use your hip to it. Okay. Everybody heard the different sound. I have to put the stress on that again. If you try to practice these strikes, the difference for you to notice is within the sound. Sometimes it's very difficult to judge it, whether you're better or whether you're not better. If the sound is much more deeper, like that's the difference, a slap or the sound goes deep inside. So the sound is deep and low, it means it reached it and it went beyond. That stays on the surface. All right, but let's do it again. And then make it a bit speedy. Any difference?
Yeah.
How's that feel?
That's good.
Very good, again? Very good. Now, when you raise it all the way, I want you to raise it halfway through.
Okay.
All right? Don't go all the way. Just go halfway and put the same movement. Remember, movement does not change.
Right.
Okay. Excellent. Very good. Now, quarter of the way. It literally sits on the front of your shoulder. Right there.
Okay.
Use everything. I said movement. Very good. A little tricky part. As soon as you do that, I want you to do this. Hop. Tuck it down. So body weight, it travels further down rather than stays behind it. Okay, again. There we go. Within the what? 3 minutes? That's the difference. Okay, now, I want you to keep that fist right in the front of that part. Okay, there is. There is the face, there is the chin. There is no room, yeah? Someone behind it, someone holding you, is pushing you forward, is pushing you backwards, all right? So you don't have a time or movement to gain it, right? This is what I want you to do. Try to repeat slowly after me. You're gonna punch it, I'm just gonna move it. Now this is what we do, look. That's it. That's it. Faster you move that, look. You know the belly dancers,
right?
Can you do that? There we go. Gentle, come on. Yeah? Swing it. This is the half of your punch. Do it now again. There we go. It's very good. Okay? This is it. That's all it takes. Few stages, few different exercises. We're going to show you much more than that. But I try to make it simple. Is any different?
Oh.
Strength-wise?
Yeah, no.
Okay. You feel more comfortable?
Mm-hmm.
There you go. It's very simple. Okay? Let's try it sometime. Same thing. Raise it back and run it through it, like it's not existing. Very good. Yeah, that's the difference. Look at the, you know. Same size as my legs.
look at that. There you go. Right. So it's a good thing they're not fighting in the American football. Halfway full. Yeah. Put it halfway. Turn. Yeah. And just go for it again. There we go. Okay. Now quarter way through. Just a quarter. That's it. Your arm is there. So that's it. Like. Yeah? Right there.
Yeah.
Go for it. Drop your fist. Turn your fist in. There we go. Do you need any more proof? Very good. Going back to someone. See, that's the good thing. We're all different sizes and shapes. Everybody, you know, there's a lot of people going to say, you know, big guy is easy to punch. But again, it's not about size. It's about skills. All right? So we're going to Mike. No offenses to your size.
No.
Very good. Step, step. Right. Go. Very good. Again. Together. All right. So, here. Now, let go. Bravo. Bravissimo. Stop. Stay where you are. Let go. Excellent. Now, going back again from the beginning. Next thing. This is what I want you to try to do. I'll do it. You repeat after me. You're not going to move no arm either. Now we're going to move the body. We're going to substitute the right opposite, right? Do you remember what we did? We used the arm, didn't we? Now, this is what we do. We're going to step back. We're going to use no arm whatsoever. Look, arm is sits there. There's no change in the angle. There's no change in anything. We're using the movement. Okay, can you try to add to that? Do not even twitch your arm. It sits there like it's been, you know, sort of. Okay, now, this is what I want you to do. Look at my. You're almost driving your body forward. Yeah?
Okay.
Arm is there. Now, step and body. That's it. Okay, go for it. Now we got 120, 130 kilos behind it. How's that? Difference? Now, what I'm trying to show you. No one likes to be punched. Whether you're professional or whether you are just a simple, normal guy from the street. No one. So, question is, punch has to be delivered. It means you have to move. Whether this is offensive movement or offensive movement. Defense and offense. This is beginning to explaining how to deliver this punch. If you're offensive or if you're defensive. Okay? Right. Step again and do it again. That's lovely. Bend your leg. Forward leg. Bend it. Very good. One more time. And bravissimo. You want to try that?
Yeah, yeah.
So basically what it is, you're moving your body, arms ain't not moving at all. Fist position is extremely important. Main thing, remember, is not such places here. Has to be one knuckle, two knuckle, three knuckle, or whatever. All surface of the fist is a connection point. The more flatter it will connect to any part of the body, whichever is connected to, the less damage you will get to yourself. It's very, very simple. The more pinpointed the strike will connect it to certain surfaces, the more chances you will gain this sort of injury. And especially if you do this for fun or a living, when you have a wrapper and you have a glove and you have some sort of meat part or whatever, as soon as you take them down, you come out on the street, tick, injury. Your arm and the fist, it does not get used to it. All right? So the main point is connect it with whole surface of your punching, you know, punching arm. Okay? Again, some people would like to close their fist, roll their fingers inside. I don't really like that, and I'll explain to you why. As soon as you roll your fingers inside out, for example, I'll show you. Yeah, right there. Roll it in like you normally do. That's it, very good. If you connect it to a very, very hard surface without paddings, very often, if you swing it to somebody, you can connect it with that side of the knuckles. And when it connects it, it will do that to the wrist. It will snap the wrist. Do you understand? So my point is, if you let them down like that, straight, really straight, and you put that on the top. So when you strike it, you just strike it by the surface of the skin, there. Even though it's connected to that, it will be connected flat.
Right.
So that will not put no pressure like that. If you put the pressure on that, see, it bend in my wrist.
Yes, sir.
Right? If you keep it flat, keep it flat. Keep it flat. Whatever much as like to put it, it will not bend the wrist. So injury will not occur. Okay? Very simple trick. Okay. Put this on and do it a few more. Just with a step. Step, move. Blow it. That's nice. Different?
Yeah.
How does it feel?
I mean, I can tell you personally from the effects of before, I mean, he's a big puncher anyway. But when you add that motion to it, and that, it's almost like a whip, and what happens at the point of impact is not even just going into the pad here, it's going right up and into my shoulder. And so if you're doing this and you're training it, the pad holder, be a little careful, make sure that you hold some structure, because when the strike gets developed, it's going to go right into that shoulder.
What within percentage, how much you would say did that brought a power behind it from before and now?
It's double the power.
Double the power.
There's no question.
Okay, so that's the easy. You will get that and you see that and you'll try to learn it just for the simple purpose to have better fighting skill. That's all. We don't try to change your style. What? Try to do it again, one more time. That's nice. That's a good connection, huh? Difference? Very good. Okay. All right, same thing. Keep your arm, step forward, and drive your body weight forward. Okay. There we go. I want you to twist your hip a little bit. There we go, very nice. With him is different story. He's not come from the fighting world, but he's just a normal guy who works whatever he does, okay? But now and then, like you explained to me before, do people come and try to take advantage of you, even though you look apart, yeah?
Yeah.
People who have arms, you know, knives, guns, whatever. So things like that happen. That will, is a very good chance it will prevent that happening.
Actually, Mike, I mean, you're Tony's trainer. You should hold the pad for, okay. You feel it for yourself. Perhaps the full one you should feel.
Okay. Try to mix it between the step. So you have 50% of the step, right? You know the step, but arm is still involved. Okay. Try to mix it now. I'll show you how to do it. Look, step. I'm sitting there. Do you see what I mean? If at any point, I try to jump ahead of myself, I do apologize. If at any point I come and try to raise it, to strike someone high heavily, first thing, I'll get boom, popped. If someone even semi-decent, yes or no?
Right.
Like professionals, yes. What'd you do? Yeah? Anyone try, boom. You give him a little, you know, eye refreshener. Right, here. So your arms are sitting in the front of you because first of all, you have to defend yourself, wrestle the move, especially in your plan of game. Yeah, boom. Do you know what I mean? Remember, very, very often, for a lot of people who's very traditional, it does not seem to be dangerous. That's where you gain a bit more. Do you know what I mean?
Right.
And someone there is almost like feels like he's gonna go and try to do the tackle or something,
right.
Yeah? But and then remember, with the chin, all you need is just to glimpse him, and it's all over. No one gets any advantage. Once you glimpse him, you're finishing him. Yeah? Sit on the top of him and do the whatever. That's all you do. That was that.
It's heavy.
Very good. Let's do that. A mixture, so in between the stop and the movement. So, a machine. Jesus. Sweet Lord Jesus.
Yeah,
how is that?
Twice.
Is there a difference since, I don't know, what was the train last time? Yesterday?
Yeah.
But different?
Twice heavy.
There we go. You're more than welcome.
Oh, yeah,
sure. Right. Okay. Now, do you want to have a go as well?
Yeah.
Have
sure.
A go.
Sure.
Try that. Again, for everyone, this is the educational part. No, without proving anything, we're not trying to put someone down and someone up. We're just adding to all different kind of guys, and you'll see the result. Simple as that. There we go. Look at that. Bravissimo. Excellent. What can I say? Okay. How long does it take? With a proper guidance, yeah, and a good explanation why actually we're doing this, we can achieve a lot even today. Okay?
Okay, so you've seen the basic structure of striking. the full strike movement, using the hip, getting the body into the strike, and even shortening it down to, you know, as much as a couple of inches. And now what we're going to talk about is using the whole body as a weapon. We're going to cover the basic strikes with the strikes and the strike points with the closed fist. We're going to use open hands, fingers, elbows, shoulders, knees, head, everything. Then we're going to talk about the placement. We're going to touch into a little bit of the anatomy, about where to strike people. Now, for those of you who are interested in pressure points, what I will say to you is that you can't be over concerned about specific pressure points on the body, because in combat, you're not going to be looking for them. Or where is it? But there are certain areas and structures that will affect the person when you strike them a lot more than if you were to strike them anywhere. So Val will cover this, and we'll bring Tyler on over on now, and start you with the basic.
This way. Yep.
The basic structure, body position, hand position on the body, and the basic drills to work around.
Okay, going back to where we started. Anytime you're affecting a human muscle tissue, whether this is the big part of the body, big chunk of the muscle, small, tiny, around the ribs, around the leg, it will start to be affected by the pain. If you put it, you know, push it forward, now you feel a bit of comfortable, a bit of pain, you start resisting it. See, even his body goes forward. This is what happened if the fist coming within the striking. This is, I'm slowing down the striking part. It goes in, connecting it, affection, a pain, tension, pain again, further. That's how it works, step by step. So what we're trying to do, we're gonna try to find and every single small and a big group of muscle within the body and try to push it to the point it will become tense because of the pain, right? Simple as that. So for example, you put it on the solar plexus, slightly below, make sure, there. And you slowly start pushing it forward. As soon as you feel the resistance, it's a very, very tricky part. As soon as you feel the resistance, feel the resistance? Yeah? Hup. You go beyond the resistance. Yeah?
Yeah.
There we go. You're pushing again, there is resistance. As soon as you feel that, you give him a little nosh. Did it go in?
Yeah.
Very good. Yeah. Again, you push it, whoop, resistance. That's your ballistic strike. That's what happened behind it. That's what I'm trying to explain. Slowly travels, connects, body reacts, and it still went beyond. That's why it's affection.
Yeah.
You feel it?
Yeah.
Just a little demonstration, a little tiny one. Keep it tense. There, look. Slow. Same effect?
Yeah.
It happened much, much faster than we can just even imagine it. Because we have a so-called thing called self-defense. What it means is, that's where the word self-defense comes from. Our body would like to defend itself. It does not want to die, because we have a surviving instinct. Any pain, anything coming towards to us, body will try to take care of itself, even try to repair it to a certain extent, depends on the damage. And it happened really, really quick, with a blink of the eye, even quicker than that. That's why we would fail to notice. Do you understand what I mean?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, this is the drill number one. This is what you're trying to do. You put the fist on whichever part, underneath the chest, just below the chest, in the middle of that, underneath, any way you like it to. You put it on, you press it. Hop, as soon as you feel him starting resisting and putting, you know, tension towards to you, you still sort of like popping in, right?
Yeah.
You will start gaining a very, very good habit to stop pushing your arm backwards. That's what the normally striking do. And they're pushing it back. So literally, well, just you brushing him, sometimes harder, sometimes less. So in that case, just do it a little bit, yeah? Each strike, yeah? You're right, sorry.
Yeah, you're fine.
Each one of them goes boom, 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 like you've been hammered.
Yeah.
Yes or no?
Yeah, absolutely.
Even though it doesn't look like it, I'm much smaller than him. It's got nothing to do with me being smaller or him being bigger. It's how you apply that within, you know, sort of fighting or whatever. That's first exercise. Second thing, for you to learn it quickly. Now imagine this, the man is standing there and try to fight at me. You know, there you go. Now, this is the basic position of a man. When he stands like that, you have to understand what groups of muscles are tense, what are relaxed, where the body weight is, where the body weight isn't, right? So for example, if I fit my arm underneath, is is forward arm, there, yeah? I can feel a bit of tension here because you raised your arm. If I go under, I can feel even more because that's where the affection is. If I go a little bit below, it's empty. It's a hole there because it's not supposed to be tense.
Right.
Unless you raise your arm and you swing it a big all punch, right. Then it's even more open. But when you raise it down there, again, it becomes tense. There you go. You can't even punch it through. So what I'm trying to say, in a certain conditional movement, certain muscles are tense, and certain muscles are relaxed. And when you throw in it, it becomes slightly changed. Certain muscles are relaxed, certain become tense. Yeah? If you will learn it when and where and what time you strike, then you make your job much, much easier than you can even imagine. Right? Let's say, for example, you raise your arms. If I step under, let's say, can I give you good affection?
Yeah.
Can I knock it down? Very good. If you lower it yourself down and close it, I can't even reach it, but if I reach it, tense yourself? Anything? Nothing?
No.
Okay, very good. Now, raise your arm and throw the strike. Whoop, you missed me. Yeah? Good?
Yeah.
Very good.
Yeah.
If I just simply, while you're standing there, go like that, anything? Not much.
Not much, yeah.
Not much. Straight forward. Nothing.
No.
Right? Under, over.
Yeah.
Much more.
Yeah, much more.
All right. This is what I'm trying to explain. Depends how body is directed towards to you. Depends on which stand. Depends on which positioning. Depends what it is, from karate background, mixed martial arts, jiu-jitsu, whatever. It will always find an affection, the way to affect a certain parts of the body, right?
Absolutely.
And you become highly adjustable within a second. You don't have to know exactly where it comes from. You will judge it by his stand, you will judge it by his arms, by his position, by his movement, and then you will make your way in quite easily. Is it explainable?
Yeah, absolutely.
Understandable, right?
Yeah.
So let's make a couple more examples. There you go. Example. He's throwing his arm forward. Well, a simple jab. If your arm manages to go down underneath it, and you're throwing a straight jab forward, it's not a bad punch, but will it affect you much?
No, not as much.
Will feel you a bit of, you know, a bit of pain, but you're not going to give you that much of advantage,
right,
unless you build it up towards to that, yeah? So if you go underneath, you go boom, and then you work your way through, then it is. But what I'm trying to say, each punch you're going to throw it from now on, I want you to get as much out of it as you can.
Sure.
Do you know?
Bang for the buck.
Yeah, once you've done it, we finish, because our goal is to achieve the hardest punches you can ever imagine right in the middle of street if you need, so in the middle of shopping mall, even just for that, you know, in the middle of ring, because sometimes you're tired, you run down, and the guy is much better than you, so it's no chances, but you still have to bang him. Yes or no?
Yeah, absolutely.
There you go. So you're throwing it, boom. That, as we said, it's not very good. But if you step a little bit forward and you run your body around it into the underneath his ribs into the floating ribs, will that go?
Yeah, it's already tensed right there.
The ribs are go down. Very good. Right hand, another example. Step in, right? See this muscle here. Yeah, punch it here, it's a good strike. But will it affect it much?
No.
Just give you a simple pain.
Yeah.
Very good. If I go in the solar plexus, gotta be semi-decent.
Yeah.
Right? If I come in and I go into the chin or into the neck.
Much more.
Bad.
Yeah.
Right? Again, right hand comes up, whoop, same thing, around here, because I'm too close, let's put it from here.
Okay.
Let's do it this way, sorry. If I step into that, and I'm too close, for me, it takes a bit of while to raise it and bang it, it ain't gonna wait it. So like I said, body has a whole weapon. Step in under, and you bury it your forearm within his back. All right, now we're going towards to much more use of different parts of your body. Again, step in, whoop, yeah? Lift it up, drop it down.
Yeah.
We will try to explain to how to strike, but nevertheless, you've got to know the positioning, the places, okay? We're gonna start with the head. You know, I have to reach as a tall guy. Right, remember, anything to do with forehead is no. Do not go there. You will break your arm. A lot of people within experience, especially older people, they will purposely put the forearm towards to your fist and they will break your fist. Do not go into the forehead, no. Now, on the sides of the face here, where the bone structure is very soft, I would not recommend it to punch either. unless you want to have a really, really serious problem with police, you will kill the guy. Because it's a very soft tissue, it's not even bony tissue. You can reach it to the brain with a blink of the eye. Yep. Okay, now, ears. Very good place. But not the fist. Open hand, yes. Closed fist, no. You will not reach it anyway. You will break his ear, but you're not going to be no affection. It's just going to bleed from his ear. But if you pump him with an open hand, then he will go down for half an hour at least. Right? Without even knowing what's going on with him. Underneath his ear, if you connect it even with a forward knuckle there, underneath that, why is that? It's a big nerve sensor with a big muscle there, yeah?
Yeah.
If you fit it in there and you push it slightly, see, that's what happened, right there. Straight away you have an affection, okay?
Yeah.
Now, neck, extremely good area. 50-50, a very strong possibility you will do the permanent damage, you will have a lot of issues with authorities. But if you try to save your own life, it's yes. So whichever way you fit it into the neck, perfect. In the middle of that, only in an extremely way to self-defense yourself, when his life in a serious, serious threat. It's a weapon on the scene and you already maybe be injured and you're already passing out. Only then you have a you know, not my permission, nothing to do with my permission. You can strike it there because it's deadly. Okay? Going back to that. Back of the head. Another very dangerous area. Anything, even a slap, terrible. So unless you really have to do it, don't do it. But if you do, then you're welcome. Because it's very, very gentle. You can snap his neck like that, like a chicken. Okay, going forward to that. You have a chest. What's the chest? It's a big group of muscles who are protecting your heart, which is covered as well with a chest plate. So it's very difficult to penetrate. If you bang in, you give him a lot of pain, but it's no affection. That's what we're trying to achieve with this video, affection. If you strike it, you're affecting him. Whether you disable him, whether you knocked him out, or whether you're just injuring him badly for, you know, you stop attacking him or you achieve whatever you want to try to achieve. Yeah? So that area, I wouldn't recommend it. Which is not, I cannot say about this chest. Right underneath that, if you cut it like this, anywhere from here to here, it's a very, very good area to strike. Because it goes straight into the lungs, all 3 points. Yeah?
Yeah.
Further point like here is not just affecting the lung, it's affecting the heart. That one particularly will hurt in the blood flow. There. Just a little touch, how you feel it?
Yeah.
Because there's a big blood vessel there. Same thing in here, yeah? So it's a 1, 2, 3. Anywhere around here is not nice.
No.
Very good. Okay? Before we go down any further, I would like to mention that the arms. Not many people knows about it, but it's extremely good. Remember, why arm is very easy to strike? First of all, the arm is going to be always next to you. Second of all, it's only a bone, tendon, and a muscle, and nothing else. If you do strike it, it hurts. It does a big, big time. So when the people do strike it, very slow. You can always miss him, either in the forearm, yeah?
Yeah.
Underneath the forearm, if you're not sure, you know, you don't want to break a distance.
Sure.
Whatever strikes are coming, you don't want to fight anymore afterwards,
no.
Right? One of the best ones you can have is, sorry.
I'm good.
When it goes into the forearm, it's almost like it goes halfway inside out. Almost like a snatch. Or, even better, if you would like to stop this before it even starts, there we go. Biceps. That part. This part we really like. You know? The one. The only. Every man likes it. But this is one of the most weakest muscles in the body. Hard, but weak. Within impact. If you strike it through, you go, see that?
Yeah.
It goes straight in through the bone.
Yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah.
So if you're a newcomer and would like to come out and test your skills, I won't recommend it. But if you will, without even listening to my concern, that's the thing. It's the arms. Yeah?
Yeah.
Right? And then you have an open space and you can enjoy it, the skills and whatever.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, going back to solar plexus. Everybody knows about it. It's a very nice place. It's not damaging. It's very good affection. You strike it and people go down because it's affecting the sternum right inside in there. For you guys who don't know what cisternum is, it's a place, a little tiny place like that, who produces certain juices to digest your food. Okay, that's all you want to know. Okay, ribs, marvelous place. Ribs, basically in the body, within, sitting underneath the solar plexus and the chest plate, for the reason is to cover vital organs. On the right hand side is the liver. That's why you're using every day on Friday, especially. Okay. On the left hand side is a spleen, place which is clean your blood, and put it antibiotics in within. Okay. Now, if you strike it in the ribs, any side from here to back there, there, low of pain, it'll go down. On the side, you'll definitely break it. On that side, not just it's gonna go down and the ribs will be broken, it will never gonna come up for the next 40 minutes. Terribly, terribly bad. Because when it goes through the ribs, it will reach, in that side, it will reach into the liver. And this is almost like, I don't know, have a hammer across your head.
Yeah.
Okay? That side, same thing. As soon as you reach it within the spleen, through the ribs, same, terrible. Pain is like you've been stabbed with a hot nail through.
Yeah.
I have done it, I mean, I've experienced it before, not pleasant. Okay, further down to the stomach. Stomach area will be painful, but a lot of people can hold on to that. Even though it will be, you know, a lot of affection, but people will still be standing and try to fight their way through. Unless, when you're using that, it's two ways. One, it goes up, it will reach within side out to solar plexus and it goes spread into the lungs and heart, or down, it will go into your private parts.
Yeah.
Ugh.
Yeah.
Not pleasant. You felt that before?
Yeah, I did.
Right? Okay, so remember direction. Within the stomach, either it can go up, see, that's the difference. Oop,
yeah.
Shoulders even popped out. Or it can go down through the private parts into the legs.
Yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Very good. Now, going further. If you look at the body structure, where the place where the legs are attached to the body, right? Like a slight little cut here, yeah? Like a muscle, the tendon connected between this and that.
Yeah.
Anywhere you put that in anybody, it's very, very, you know, very uncomfortable feelings. Anywhere you put around here, you know,
yeah.
You don't feel right.
Yeah.
So this is a very nice place to strike it, whether you're kicking it, kneeing it, yeah? Or you're striking it through. It's a nice place,
yeah.
Especially when people do try to sort of kick you or something, you know, and you move away. It's nice to strike it. It will give you good affection. First of all, he's not going to kick you anymore. Second of all, he'll be limping for a while.
Yeah.
All right. Further down. Can I just show you a little bit?
Yeah, sure.
Very strong quads. Within the quads, if you look at it halfway right way through there, in the middle, if you put your finger and push it, you feel that?
Yeah.
Right? That's the place to strike. A very nice place, very effective. On the side that, not directly in the middle, three quarters down, there. That's where the nerve, big nerve running through to the leg. Yeah. See it? It's like a little hole. Right?
Yeah.
Another best place to run it. Or inside the quads, right here.
Yeah.
Not halfway, probably just about three quarters, a little bit less. Yeah. And only good thing about it, because it's the biggest blood vessels within the body. If you strike it here, you will disrupt the blood flow, and then the blood pressure will start chunking up and down, down to the point people try to sort of clear their eyes when all was going on, right? Going further, kneecaps. Everybody knows about kneecaps. Directly down, if you strike it within its body weight, you will snap it. Sidewise, as a kicking, you know, like a Muay Thai sort of type kicking, lower it down. If you kick it, you will get its cut reach down. Inside out as well, same thing. You will break it.
Yeah.
If you are a good, successful striker, instead of making it big, you know, flows, you make it simple. Whoop, short, right?
Yeah.
If you lower it down, then it's, you know, you will snap it,
yeah.
Okay? Further down, right here, which is the place it's been always covered in any sports games, like, you know, soccer, football, many other places, hockey, they always have a shin pads.
Yeah.
Why? It's one of the weakest bones in the body. You see it very often in the telly when people do fight in K1 or whatever fights they do, it goes boom, and it breaks his own leg.
Yeah.
Ha! It goes down, because it's very weak. That's why a lot of people do kicking heavy objects and bags and woods and wools and anything to make it stronger. I wouldn't recommend it because by the age of 40, 45, you'll be walking funny.
Yeah.
I used to be a good fighter. You know, but you know, come on.
Yeah.
I wouldn't recommend it. So you're using your foot directly in the middle, inside or out, right?
Yeah.
So that's the basic things. Yeah. And again, I forgot about it, main thing. The back, all good back. In a lot of fighting, people do not strike in the back because it's totally illegal. Now, in what I'm trying to explain to you and show it to you, here you have full permission of everyone who do the street fighting to fight it and strike it in the back. Because back is does not have, let's say, defensive parts as the front does. Back has nothing. Any way in your back you strike is twice as worse as any way in the front.
Yeah.
First of all, remember, everything we do it front-wise. We fight front-wise, we walk front-wise, we don't walk backwards. All our life is about the front. We have defense here, they have defense here. We have muscles in the stomach to take strikes, don't we? Do we have muscles in the back to take strikes?
No.
No, we don't. And what most dangerous is, we have a spine running through here. Anything comes to the spine is bad, it's really bad. So remember, if you have to defend yourself, if someone tries to take you down, if someone turns his back to you, or you manage to sort of put yourself slightly behind him, this is the very good areas to strike and try to get rid of your attacker. Down to the point, it will drop down and will be paralyzed for the rest of his life. Anywhere in the spine. Here, anywhere you want to strike it in the spine, you will achieve whatever you're trying to achieve. And it will have a sometimes even lethal effect. Again, ribs at the back as well. You strike it, it'll go down big time. Okay? So I think that's about it in the body. That's all you need to know for now. Again, pressure points are very good, but no one's gonna give you no pleasure to try to dig your way in and try to affect whatever. It's not gonna happen. Before you do that, they will knock you out and they start jumping on your head. Okay? So now, going back to all your body is your own weapon. Remember, when we do have no weapons, anything goes. You know this term, anything goes. From your fingers, to your fists, to your elbows, your forearms, to your shoulders, to your chest, your knees, your legs, anything goes. Depends of the situation, depends of the length of the position, that's what you're gonna use. If you're close, if you're tied up with some sort of wrestling motion, people try to grab you, stuff like that, you don't have a pleasure to raise this and strike him because he will block it, he will grab you, anything can happen. So one of my favorites, for example, I'll give you an idea. If someone comes, I'm walking around with, you know, in my hands in my pockets. Someone comes really close and tries to wrestle you down, you know. You have nothing. You have, you know, sometimes when you do get nervous, you can't even get them out. Ah! It looks like you're playing with your nuts. So you can't get them out. But when he leans forward, you have your forehead. Forehead is very good to use for that point because remember, this is the direction your forehead is striking. On the top of the chin, on the bottom chin, when it strikes, look where it goes to, all the way inside. How's that feel? Yeah?
I feel it.
It drive it all the way through. Because the bottom jaw is like sitting on a fork, like this, on the bones here. When you're pushing it down, it's a very good affection because it's affecting all the way back to the back of the head, inside, for the brain, like that. Sorry.
Very fine.
Okay? All right? So anything comes to you in the closed position, you have full permission to use your forehead. Because it's strong, it's designed to be like that. Sometimes even big 45 does not take it. I've read it through you so many times. Yeah? Anyone grab you, anyone, you know, just like sort of tackle, things like that. You know, you have a forehead to use. Not just directly, you can brush it through, you know, in that way. You can strike it down. And one of the best thing, one of the very good thing, you know, if you look at it in area here, like a triangle, you call a color area. Yeah, that's where basically the bronx is touching it on the top of the lungs, you know, your breathing system. So anywhere on that, you strike it. If anyone going way through, you know, right? Okay?
Yeah.
It does give him like initial shock, right? You can use your head. Second one, you can use your fingers. Fingers can be used to, again, to the certain extent of your strength. If you are very strong, you can even use it to grab his ear and rip his off. If you are not very strong and big guy, if you, you know, sort of medium size, small size, or female, you don't have a pleasure to have a big forearms to grab it and rip his skin off, right? You can use it for his eyes, you can use it underneath his ears, you can use it underneath his nose, yeah? You can use it into the groin area. And if you are even semi-strong, anywhere where the loose skin is, you grab the skin, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Sorry.
That was fine.
Yeah, the loose skin is a very, very good thing. Remember, the biggest and most sensitive organ within our body is the skin. Every single centimeter covered of your meaty parts is an organ, and it's a very, very sensitive organ. So when you grab it, sorry.
No, you're fine.
Yeah? And people do try to do something to you. You can, you know, especially at the back here, underneath the lat, yeah? When you grab it, yeah?
Yeah.
You can literally, poof, I mean, if you're strong enough, okay? This is with the fingers. Now, fist we already went through a little bit. Open hand. Open hand is a marvelous, marvelous thing. Why? Because remember, psychologically, for us to strike, it takes a certain conditional movement, a certain idea. For example, you close your fist, you become slightly tense, you raise it, and you aim it and you strike it. With the open hand, you don't need to do that. Because the actual thing of closing fist and aim it is already not there anymore. All you need is just a slap. Like females. Every time a girl slap a man, it always goes through. Did you ever notice that?
Yeah.
Always. Even though they're very good fighters and this and that, stays there, she goes, hey, you bastard, boom! And if you got the hell, she's out again, you know?
Yeah.
Boom, and you knocked her out. If she's not your girlfriend, I'm just kidding. No, but what I'm saying is, it does not require certain conditional movement. That's why it becomes very successful with the slap.
Yeah.
My recommendation, I'm not gonna say I've done it or not, let's say I practiced before. Open hands, if you put it right here, just like that, and you put it almost like, you know when you wrestle to somebody and you put your arm on the top of his neck to hold on to him, right? If that fits in there, it's a perfect match. Because just imagine the velocity and the power of your movement when it's, you know, think what can happen.
Yeah.
Huh? You'll take the head down, right? Then, that can, if you put your arm slightly bent like this, so it's almost like an air cushion, yeah? If that can line down on the top of the ear, it will create the air bubble, which is travel through inside out and will pop his ear from inside out. It won't hear you, it will bleed, and it's an initial shock to the brain because the shock wave will reach the middle of brain. Whatever you try to achieve is done. So if you would like to do that, one of the things you need to do, both arms can go right in the top of the, yeah? It's a little air cushion inside. It will feel the pressure.
Yeah?
Yeah, like.
Yeah.
So the air cushion goes inside. So even when you're fighting, even try to achieve stuff, when you try to take someone down quickly, you go, boop. Yeah, but if when you do it, you have to do it. If you decide to do it, you have to do it properly. Because a little tap is going to just drive him mad. He's going to, you know, do something to you. So if you do it, make sure you do it to the point so you'll sit and never come up for a while. Okay? Again, if you try to stop somebody, but in a certain way, I mean, to prevent the violence. Open hand is a very good thing to work on the top of the chest. Why? Because chest, why, just a question. Why people never thought why chest is very, very heavily protected? Because it's covering very, very important vital organs, lungs. You can't breathe for 1 minute, you're dead. Well, okay, 3 minutes, you're dead. It's very important part, eh?
Yeah.
Heart. It's not pumping, you're still dead. So that's why we have a, almost like a bulletproof vest on the top of our body, naturally. It's a muscle and a bony part to protect this. So if that's supposed to be protected, that's supposed to be very important, right? And it's very sensitive in a certain way. So if you run your open hand through his chest, okay?
Yeah.
Makes a difference.
Yeah.
and cool it down a bit. Because remember, when people become wound up, people become angry, people become cautious, people become stupid, they want to do something to you. Physiologically, what happened? All the blood, not all of it, but a lot of them, travel up and stays above the solar plexus. That's what the people call high blood pressure. Did you see the angry people before?
Yeah.
Are they red-faced?
Yeah.
Why? Blood pressure, very good. Fear, people red? Yes, anything, right? That's why it's very easy to spot the fighter. When it comes down, if it's red, it's really, really worrying. When a guy comes down white, as you like, he's even worrying even more because all the blood in his limbs, and he's like that, because his brain is not functioning. If you find a guy who's fighting against you in his normal color, then, you know, we have a bit of issue because he's fully in control. That's how to read the purple. So if your blood always up there, all the blood, you know, he's really, really trying to do something to you, right? Let's try to do that. This is what I want you to do. Yeah. You want to breathe like me? Go on, breathe. Come on. Yeah. Special breathing to get your blood up, to raise your blood pressure. Very good for the professional fighters. Okay? Do you feel that? Yeah. Wound up? Okay, now. No more?
No.
Very good. Okay, so striking with that, you will achieve certain goal, which is you can cool someone down. You will not knock him out, you will not damage anything, but you will cool him down in a point he will start thinking clear what he's trying to do to you. Or maybe he'll completely decide not to do anything. Do you understand what I mean?
Yeah.
Very good. Again, a little bit lower, open hand. Very often, open hand is a very good idea to strike it through the solar plexus or rib cages. When especially people try to sort of tackle you down. This has happened very often because everybody wants to do the mixed martial arts and people have a bit of drink, they still go for your legs, all of them do.
Yeah.
So when they do come close to you, it's a very good point to just stop somebody. Just stop within the ribs,
yeah.
Within the solar plexus. Yeah. Oops, sorry.
No, you're fine, you're fine.
Yeah, you sure?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. 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 Effective?
Yeah.
Very good.
Yeah.
Right. So that can be used. All right. Again, more slaps into that area. Very good slap. Excellent slap. But if you decide to do it, you have to do it to the point it's completely out. Why? People don't like, a man don't like to be struck in this area. I don't like it. Do you like it?
No.
No, it would drive you mad.
Yeah.
You become stupid.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah. Because we like this part to be approached gently, not roughly, right? So
absolutely.
If you whack it like that, you better be do it good because you're gonna go mental, right? Okay, now, we did the arms, we did the open hands. Elbows. Elbow is a funny thing. Any way you strike it within your open bony part, you will, very good chance, you will chip it, you will have an issue for many, many months, or even though years ahead of you. When I do it with my meaty part of the forearm, just there, yeah? And the movement is almost like a whip movement, yeah? It's not short, I mean, it can be short, but it's not sort of reversibly limited, like, you know, in traditional sort of martial arts, like, ah! It's relaxed from the shoulder point, there. That's how it goes slowly, yeah, there. Oop. Literally almost like a brush. It goes in, touches it, and naturally goes back. Yeah, there, boom, there. Boom. Maybe it doesn't look hard, but that was like,
it's very hard, yeah.
Yeah,
it's okay. Harder than the short, you know, like more like martial arts elbows that you see thrown.
Yeah, extremely good part, especially if people on the top of you, yeah? You know, they try to get your neck, they try to do, you know, take you down and anything, because sometimes it's often we struggle, we don't know anything about it. You're punching him, no affection. He's a strong man, yeah? So you kick his arms out, and the ribs, actually very effective. It's a very good movement. Let's do it again, slowly, yeah? You lift it up whichever way. You push it away, you lift it up, and you draw it through his rib cage. Again, slow. Whoop. Okay? So you can use that. Reverse elbow. Anything when people do come to you, when people do try to take an advantage from behind, yeah, you've got to know how to strike it backwards. Again, if you just simply try to pump it, like in the movies, it's not going to work unless you're going to use full motional direction. What it means is you have to find a bit of movement. Yeah? You have to find a bit of movement there. Yeah? Break it. Boom, boom. Okay? So even on the top of that, it will still make a sense.
Yeah.
Especially if someone tackle you down, you know, like a typical wrestling move. You have an elbow, you can drive it through his spine, on the back of his neck, yeah? Or drive it through it, through his muscle tissue. Okay? I think it's more than enough for now. And then we have knees. Knees are very good. Why? I don't like when people jumping around with knees because you, I mean, a semi-decent wrestling guy, he'll take you down, he'll, you're not going to jump again, he's going to finish you. Knees are very good for semi and a close position. When you're almost close to the guy or when you're very close to the guy. Why? Because like I said to you before, do you remember quads? Direct hit, straight, yeah? On the side or inside there. Yeah, that's the difference. Just a little tighter move. Difference?
Yeah.
Feel it?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Or inside out. Effective?
Yeah, absolutely.
Very good. Hamstring. Oh, sorry, not hamstring. Shin. Within the quads. Extremely good. If you know how to do it. It's almost like this ballistic directioning. When you're kicking it, it does not simply run it through. It's almost like knocking it inside out there. Does it make sense?
Yeah.
Almost like a semi-brush.
Yeah.
That's the difference. Look, this is the kick. And this is the brush.
And it went all the way through.
Yeah?
Yeah. The kick I just felt on the outside, but the brush I actually felt on my...
Right through inside out.
Yeah.
Yeah? That's exactly the same thing with the knees.
Yeah. Yeah.
As long as it goes through inside, then you have a result. Mm-hmm. That's what we're trying to actually achieve here, a result each time. Same thing with that goes in the body.
Yeah.
Yeah? You can go underneath the ribcage, you can go directly into the solar plexus, you can go up, upside down, boom, yeah?
Yeah.
Or you can go up and down, there. Okay?
Effective.
Yeah, they all do. Okay, kicks. I like kicks, but I like certain kicks. I don't like high kicks, not because I can't raise my legs, I can raise my legs, but I don't want to raise my legs that high because it's very easy to be taken down. It's very easy to be kicked back, punched back. You see hundreds of different things happen throughout even UFC and MMA fights. People raise their hands, it steps in close, clamp you down on the floor. Legs are effective because they're strong, but legs are very dangerous because you have to be extremely fast with the legs. And generally speaking, your arms are faster than your legs because we always put the most stress to the certain parts of the body. Because the wrestling condition with more than martial arts, a lot of them wrestle, legs become less effective than they used to be. Because what the people are trying to do, they try to break the distance quicker to you. And then by the time you're on the floor and he's sitting on the top of you and taking your teeth inside, putting in your mouth, all right? I like the kicks not further than hip level. And again, when I do kick straight forward. No, that's just straight forward, straight inside. So when the kick goes in, look at the body. I want you just take a notice of the body. That's what the body does. It's affecting the whole body. It's not just affecting one leg. See? All body is just curving in. So the direct kick, it goes straight down, okay? In a very traditional ways, when the people do approach that point, kick does not become successful enough because obviousness of the kick. If I stand in here and it's almost like you can tell I was about to throw my leg into, right? So even though a lot of guys do marvelous kicks on the backs, on the pads, on the kicking shields, when it comes down to actual business, you can hardly see any knockouts or you can hardly see any injury occur because of that. Because you know, I mean, ain't no fools anymore around here, anywhere. You know, more or less you can tell what's about to happen.
Yeah.
The speed of the situation, that's the difference. But, you know, the reading of situation ain't that bad.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So if you hide the action of yours, you will achieve your goal much more quicker than if you try to sort of become faster and three times stronger than your opponent. If you're equal to your opponent, then it's a questionable who's going to win. What happens if he's better than you? Then it's the issue. You know, if I don't know how to fight, I see someone like that's approaching me and he tried to do something nasty to me, then I don't have weapon on me. That, you know, I give up everything I try to, you know, whatever I have in my pockets. Yeah. Even though it's not guaranteed, he's not going to do anything to me. Yes or no?
Yeah.
So then it has to come up a skill. For example, this is the difference. That's what I'm going to show you. I'm going to show you obvious kick, not kick, just touch, yeah. And then less obvious. And you tell me is any difference. Yeah? So. See it?
Yeah.
Very good. Saw it, but when it's too late.
Yeah, yeah.
Yes or no?
Yeah.
So that's my point. Hide your actions. I will try to help you and explain to you how to hide your actions to achieve something you were looking for. If you're obvious, yeah, nowhere near you're gonna go. So just become less obvious. Get, you know, get certain thing, sorry. So, you okay?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what I mean. Less obvious, more successful. Yeah? And again, kicking is a good thing, you know? Like I mentioned it before. Quads, direct, yeah? Side, inside. Excellent. Tendons connecting leg to the body, neck. Very good. Underneath the rib cages. I want to just touch.
Yeah, yeah.
There, sideways. Hidden kicks. He's fighting to you. You step away, boom. Because it's not seen. You can be good, you can be not good, but when you become not obvious, you become extremely good. Because people don't know how to read your actions. No idea.
Yeah.
Yeah? If they're not seeing you, if they're not seeing the way you're fighting, they never study your style, then it's, oh, they're cautious. So you do almost like what they do, everybody else. Boom. But you do it to a different standard, and you win. Make sense?
Yeah.
So.
Thank you. Hi, I'm Jack Spirko, the other half of Franklin Spirko Media, and one of the producers and the director of Ballistic Striking with Val Riazanov and the Ballistic Combat System. We had a lot of really great people here today from a lot of different backgrounds. We brought to you an offensive lineman that used to play collegiate football, weighing 275 pounds. We brought the owner of the facility himself and a highly trained martial artist in his own right. And we brought you an MMA fighter with a great record. I thought it would be a good idea, since we have put out a lot of material on ballistic striking in the past, a lot of other people that study the art have as well, and there's something that's lost in film and video because the things are so subtle. So I thought it would be a good idea today at the end to take a moment for me to interview our three actors and let them tell you for themselves exactly what it was like to experience these things with Val, not only what it was like to experience the strikes, but the frustrating nature of the very relaxed approach. So we'll go ahead and do that now.
I'm Michael West, owner of Fight Time Fitness. I'm a black belt in Taekwondo, Kempo. I've trained several years with Carlos Machado for Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. I train now with Eddie Bravo. I'm purple belt under Eddie Bravo's 10 Planet System. We've had the pleasure to train with Sean Shirk, Saxon Janjura. We have in our gym pro fighters, amateur fighters, grapplers. We promote pro fights as well.
And I mean, with that kind of background, you've probably been hit a few times in your life.
Yeah, plenty of times, plenty of times.
How can you compare maybe strikes that you felt before, especially to the torso, with some of the stuff you experienced with Val today?
You know, the heaviness of the punches, the I guess they call it the ballistic approach to it, was really an eye-opener. The videos I saw online don't do his justice in real life. It's just something different you never felt before.
It's funny you mentioned that. There's a lot of, Val's a great guy. There's some other very good Systema practitioners, Russian martial arts practitioners, and there's a lot of videos out there. And people watch those videos and they see these strikes. They think there's no way they could possibly hurt or deliver that much power. What would you say to those people now that you've been on the receiving end?
Hey, I was the same guy. I've seen the videos myself, and I was too a little bit skeptical about the power and what happens, but actually feeling it makes you a believer. The heaviness, the distance, the joint locks, the throws, it's just the control. It's just heavy and solid. There's nowhere to move. It's just, it's amazing. It's amazing.
And when we were in between scenes and we were taking some breaks, you said that you were kind of getting frustrated when you were grappling with Val because of the way there's no rhythm to respond to. And how would you describe that experience?
Right. With fighting, there's angle, there's movement, there's timing issues, there's setups and cues you work off of. He doesn't give you anything. It's almost like a natural awkwardness to his techniques. There is no feigning. It's just different. It's a whole different approach. I didn't know what to do to him.
Would you say it's a little bit intimidating at some point?
Oh, it's very intimidating. It's take him down. I wasn't sure when to go. He doesn't give you the typical angles you want to work from.
So, Tyler, after working with Val today, can you describe, first of all, for us what it's like to be hit, you know, in the solar plexus with a ballistic strike?
Okay, well, apart from, like, just a traditional strike, whether it be, like, you know, with martial arts or, like, a blunt force, like, sports-related strike, it's really concentrated in that one area, you know, whereas when Val delivered, like, the ballistic strike to the solar plexus or chest or, like, lower abdomen, it transferred in whatever direction he was driving through. So if he delivered a shot to my solar plexus, it transferred into my abdomen, and I felt kind of like almost like a vibrator rattle inside. It stunned everything, as opposed to just impacting on the surface.
And you're a big guy. You've been hit a lot of times. But would you say that when you get hit with these strikes, it's more than just the pain? It actually causes you to think twice before your next move?
Yeah. I noticed myself whenever, you know, he was showing me things, almost flinching before he even delivered a strike, just because the first one or two times that he's showing you a maneuver or a strike, you know, it rattles, you know, your frame of mind. And so you don't really know what to do next. You kind of try to find yourself trying to anticipate where it's going to come from and kind of getting off kilter a little bit.
And you've been involved in some sports, Muay Thai and football, where there's kind of a rhythm, and Val kind of seems it doesn't have a rhythm.
He's
very relaxed. Is that frustrating when you're trying to grapple with him, or?
Yeah, you know, especially in football, where they pound into your head one particular way to move and one particular way to deal with a threat or a obstacle in your way, whereas if that threat is just bouncing around all over the place, you really don't have, you know, any time to think about where to anticipate it coming from, what to do next. And before you know it seems like he's wrapping you on the chin or neck slapping you or kicking you in the leg or the thigh. So I just found it harder to, it almost demoralizes you to a point where you don't really want to, you know, fight anymore. You don't even want to spar anymore. You just kind of want to take a step back.
And then when you guys were grappling around on the ground, you probably have about a 50-pound advantage over Val with weight, a little bit of height. When you're wrestling him on the ground, you think it's the one place where you have to be tense, and he stays loose. Is that frustrating?
Well, you know, you almost get lured into a false sense of security, because when I initially went on the ground with him, I was on a top mount. I had both of his arms pinned down, and you can kind of get into a false sense of security until he kind of wriggles out of it, and you're all the while clenching up, expending all your energy, trying to catch him, you know, trying to maintain a hold on him. And it's like Val described, like trying to hold a wet rag doll, and you really can't maintain any kind of positive grip or influence his direction at all. I really just kind of left completely blowing your steam out, and all the while he has all his energy, because he hasn't really been, you know, using strength as much as he has just body position and movement.
And what would you say to the observer that says, well, while he's limp like that, I would be hitting him, or I would be, you know, twisting his neck or doing something like that?
Well, I would say in a real world scenario, if it was me and somebody that was 150, 180, 200 pounds, I don't really think there would be that, that advantage that somebody would have. And as far as if it was with Val and I took one hand off of his arms for 1 minute to start punching him and kicking him or hitting him because he was limp, just by watching how he reacts and how he's able to move and absorb and deflect any kind of punches or kicks or anything like that, I think my best bet would have been to do exactly what I did and just try as hard as I can to keep him down. But obviously that doesn't work, you know, doesn't work either, so.
Okay, Tyler, well, thanks for working with us today, and thanks for being willing to take a few shots.
Yeah, thank you.
So I'm here now with Tony Melton. Tony is an MMA fighter. Tony, tell us a little bit about your background and why you're here today.
Yes, sir. I've been boxing off and on for about 12 years now. I just started the MMA thing a few years ago. I did the jiu-jitsu and the Muay Thai. I come today to help the guys with the training, to put on the show.
You actually compete, right? So you've been competing in MMA recently. How's that going for you?
Yes, sir. I'm 7-0 with five knockouts, or actually six knockouts in the MMA game. Basically, what I learned today is I'm already a power puncher. I just learned how to make my punching more powerful than what they were before. I thought I was pretty good at it. And
climbing into that octagon, both to train and to compete, you've probably been knocked around quite a bit, hit a lot of people. You've probably taken a lot of really powerful punches from a lot of people.
Mm-hmm.
Any good fighter's going to be a strong puncher. But what's the difference to you in the impact, the way it feels when you're hit with a ballistic strike by Val?
It feels like it covers more area to me than what it getting hit by a regular punch. And when you get hit by a regular punch, to me it doesn't like hurt, I guess, in a way. But like when he was hitting me in the solar plexus, that hurt. Even with a jab, he hit me with a jab in the solar plexus, and it hurt. I've never been hit with a jab, and it's hurt me, in a way. It's weird, odd to me.
How would you describe dealing with him, like when you're grappling around him, moving with him? He's staying in that relaxed state. Does it maybe get frustrating, or does he try to tire you out with, not so much just physically tire you out, even though that can happen too, but is there a patience factor there that eventually he's waiting for you to make a mistake? Or?
It's frustrating because he's like relaxed in a way. He's not trying to engage me. He's wanting me to engage him to see how I react and see what he can do to take me down or take an advantage of me is what it feels like to me.
And last year, you said you've taken a lot of shots. You can usually absorb them pretty well. There's some, a tremendous amount of great instructors out there, Val among them, that teach this type of striking. And people watch these people get hit with these strikes and see the reaction, and they look so gentle, really, because they're short movements and what have you. To those people out there that say that these strikes can't possibly have that type of delivery, what would you say to them?
To me, I'd say it's bullshit. Cause I, to me personally, I thought the same thing. I watched it on YouTube, and so I thought the exact same thing. And until you actually get out here and do it and feel it, your perspective would be totally different than what it, for me, it is anyways.